these books talk about place names, geographical, I guess, real estate locations. These locations aren't what you would call, today we have like movies. We have like Narnia, we have Middle Earth, we have all these like fictional places that some writer created. These are real places. You have places like Betel, you have places like Hebron, you have places like Jerusalem, you have places like Shiloh, a few other places which I'll mention later in the talk that are actually mentioned in this book, and these are real places, and people or things happen in these places in the Torah, in the Tanakh, and if you go there today, you can go there today, and you can see people, Jews like you and I, who live there, and the international community, I'm not getting too political, the international community calls them settlers. Guys, I'm just going to say one political thing, if you'll permit me. Our enemies consider the entirety of Israel a settlement. Period. You can ask them. You can go on their TV channels and watch, and they're singing about Tel Aviv, they're singing about Haifa, they're singing about returning to the, from the river to the sea, X, Y, and Z will be free. So, with that said, you have people who live in these places, people who came, some of their families came back, let's say, way before the state was founded. We talk about the state was founded in 1948. No, we had the modernity people who came back in the mid-1800s, religious people. We're not talking about secular Jews from, who were like communists and all this kind of stuff. We're talking about these rabbis who got on horse and buggy. There's no kayak.com. There's no, you can fly through Russia, you can fly direct, $800. We're crying about these things today. They say it's never been harder when it's easy, and it's never been easy when it's harder when there is trouble. So at that time, people got on horse and buggy, and they traveled for months and months and months. Disease, danger, peril, Turks, Armenians, knives, stabbing animals, whatever it is. And they came to Israel little by little. They 10 people, 50 people, 100 people, big rabbis. You guys ever heard of the rabbi Rambam, Nachmanides. He came to Jerusalem in the year 12, I believe, 75. And if you guys have been to the old city, there's a big synagogue called the Kurva. He built that. And it was destroyed by the Jordanians. We rebuilt it recently. And there's a whole other prophecy about that synagogue. So the point is, there's people who've been there for years. There's people who are still there today. And actually, you guys sitting here today, you guys are participating in prophecy. Because, you guys can see it here, we had a prophet, one of our prophets' name is Amos. He actually spoke about, or Hashem spoke through him, and he said, I will bring back my people from captivity. I will plant vineyards. Captivity means like exile, Europe, wherever. Today it's like Europe, America, Australia, South America. Anywhere that's not Israel, I'm gonna bring them back. They're gonna plant vineyards, and they're gonna build cities. In those cities, you're going to plant vineyards, and from those vineyards, you're going to make wine. Friends, it's all happening. It's all happening. We have today people who are moving from places like France, places like South America, places like Australia, places like in Russia. Like one of the winemakers I'll talk to you guys about, he was born in Moscow, and his parents brought him when he was a little kid. He grew up in Israel, and he makes wine. He makes wine in a place that's like from the times of Romans. So we're basically, there's an idea in Judaism that basically time is really not like a real thing. So what we're doing is we're essentially just rewinding back, and we're almost like taking everything back 2,000 years and just continuing where we left off. When the Romans kicked us out, we're back and we're just doing what we're always doing. So you guys have a piece of paper that I left on your chairs. You left it with your neighbor. You could actually see that there's like all these places. I mean, there's only like four sources, but they're like, when I was looking yesterday, there's like a bunch of places in the Torah that talk about wine. And wine was probably one of the most, abundant and common things in Jewish society in Israel at the time. And if you look at Judaism back then as today, you literally can't have Judaism without wine. You have Kiddush, you have Abdullah, you have Sukkot, you have Pesach, four cups, you have circumcision, think of any Purim, Simchat Torah, think of any holiday,
wedding.
What? Yeah, wedding. right? You can't even get married without one. I mean, you can do great Jews, but
exactly.
Your parents like that. So with that said, guys, I just want to take you kind of I guess since we can't be in Israel today, I'm going to take you guys kind of a little tour of I guess these wineries or the people, I guess who these people are, what kind of wine they make, and some stories about the wineries. And have you taste it as well. So actually someone makes it is from Hebron, which I'll talk about later. But the winery itself, the wine is bottled in a place called Geulim. So Geulim is actually a place in Jerusalem, it's a neighborhood in Jerusalem where I used to live, and its other name, more famous name, is called Baca. So I don't know if you guys have friends who live in Baca. Baca is a place where pretty much every American who wants to live in Jerusalem, or Anglo, Australian, South African, and even French, a lot of French people coming there, so they go to live in Baca. It's kind of like America in Israel. And I guess this Frenchman decided, okay, I'm going to just find a piece of land, and I'm going to have a... I mean, he has the vineyard, his vineyard next to Hebron, but he bottles this particular wine in Baca. So it's actually... This particular wine is what they call the Gewurztraminer. It's like all the grapes in Israel, like, just to give you guys some kind of perspective, I think 6 months ago, by way of Arab or Bedouins, a few Bedouins were just wandering around some area, the areas like northern West Bank, and they found grapes, old like shriveled up grapes that are indigenous to Israel from like thousands of years ago. They found this professor. He's actually a winemaker. He's the winemaker of Boa Winery, one of the top wineries in Israel, and he's a professor at RBL University. So he's currently in the process of resurrecting these grapes, and I think in about 2 years, Israel is going to have the first proprietary grapes in 2,000 years. We're going to, you know, like Italy has Chianti, multiple channel Bialuza, we're going to have Marmawi, and there's like a few other.
Taking their seeds from these 2,000 year old grapes.
Yes. We're going, I mean, this is like mushing up stuff. This is essentially like redemption. I mean, I'm telling you guys right now, as soon as we get this wine, I'm telling you something's going to happen. Because I know, something's about to go down. I hope good.
And they have to be better and more special.
What do you mean?
They just found the best things.
No, they found these grapes. They have actually anthologies from, they have writings from Talmudic times. Like, they did actually an article about this in J-Post and CNN. And then an article is entitled Talmudic Wine. So they have actually information from those times, from writings, and then when you put it on their microscope, it's like, okay, this is it. The only thing is we have to now figure out a way how to do the biology and chemistry and figure out how to resurrect it, which is what he's doing now. This coin is found in an ancient cave right next to, just outside of Sagot. And it's actually from the year 70 AD, which is from the Great Revolt of the Jews and the Romans.
Is that the Bar Kokhba?
The Kokhba, yeah. So the cave of the so if you guys know anything about there's a man, a general named Bar Kokhba, and in his day, he was thought to be by the Rabbi Akiva thought, who was a great rabbi at the time, Rabbi Akiva thought that he was the Messiah. He was going to lead the Jewish people to redemption. Not just the redemption, but like one of the traits of the Messiah was he was a military, he would be a military leader. He would be knowledgeable in Torah, he would be very spiritual. So Rabbi Akiva really put his faith into this guy, and he was essentially, at one point, he pretty much led the Jewish forces to many victories against the Romans. Eventually they fell, mainly because of his hubris. But this wine is actually kept in the cave. Supposedly, according to the commercial that they put out, it's one of the oldest caves, wine cellars in the world, if you can call it a cellar. But it's essentially a cave, and they keep some of the barrels. I mean, they kind of use it as a, it's more of a, I guess, advertising or marketing thing. They keep some of the barrels of wine in this cave. Most of the barrels are obviously kept at their facility. But just goes to show, you walk around that whole area, and you pretty much have just a wealth of history, and you literally can't take a step anywhere without stepping on something that's from like 2,000, 3,000, 4,000 years ago. This particular house, so one thing I forgot to mention, guys, so this guy was Jacob Berg. He was 3 years old. And the way I found out that I was actually born in the former Soviet Union, so I found out that he was born, I was looking at an ad in like Omni or one of these Mishpacha magazines, and a big ad, and it says, origin Moscow, Russia. So he actually came from Moscow. His parents came from Moscow when he was 3 years old, but he grew up in Israel. He speaks full Russian, and this is a Russian Jew. If you guys know anything about the history of Russian Jews, where I'm from, pretty much the government took everything away from us. So now imagine you have a person who came from a repressive regime. He came to a place where, if you guys know some history, the Russians were actually helping the Arabs in the wars against Israel. So it's a Russian Jew who came to Israel, came to this part of Israel, started a winery. I don't have to tell you guys again, it's prophecy in action. So